81 degrees, winds blowing briskly out of the east at 10 miles an hour. A delightful afternoon for baseball as the Cubs try to knock off the Phillies for the third time in this four-game series. And our guest conductor for the seventh inning stretch, Jimmy Buffett, is on hand at the ballpark. He and Mark Grace are having some fun. Come on, Jimmy, throw some grounders out there. But a special day, too, for all the kids and kids at heart. Father's Day here at the friendly confines. And the Cubs behind Sammy Sosa try to run their record to 43-31 on the year. Let's check out the starting lineup for the visiting Philadelphia Phillies and their manager, Terry Francona. The Phillies come in a game below 500 at 35-36 on the year. Doug Glanville, the former Cubs, going to lead things off. Then it's Greg Jeffries in left field. Scott Rowland, the third baseman, bats third. At first base, it's Cub killer Rico Bronya. Then Bobby Abreu in right hits fifth. Mark Lewis at second, bats sixth. Another former Cub, Mark Parent, behind the plate. Desi Rutherford, the shortstop, hits eighth. And on the mound, pitching and batting ninth, is the pitcher, Tyler Green.
And the Pepsi defense for Jim Riggleman and the Cubs. Rodriguez, Brown, and Sosa left to right. In the infield, Hernandez, Alexander, Morandini, and Grace. And a battery of Sandy Martinez and Steve Trachsel. There's a look at Steve Trachsel going for his seventh win, and this his 15th start. He's yet to complete a game, and the wind is blowing straight in today, so a lot better day to pitch than it has been the previous three games of this series.
They see the flag standards out in center field. The Cubs come into today's game in second place in the Central Division, three games behind the Astros, who won another game in their last at-bat yesterday, beating the Reds by a final score of 9-8. Good-looking pitcher Scott Ellerton, a big, tall, 6'6" kid, won rave reviews in his major league debut. He struck out 9 Cincinnatians in that ball game, but did not figure in the decision.
I talked to Terrell Lowry before the game. He faced him in AAA ball and said that the young man throws a fastball around 95 miles an hour, has a chance to be a pretty good one, and he is a welcome addition to what has otherwise been a decimated Houston starting rotation.
And of course, Ellerton took the spot of Mike Hampton, who's on the disabled list with that strained groin. And you see the umpiring crew, the men in blue today, Bill Hahn, Angel Hernandez, Randy Marsh, Greg Bonet, the umpire, is at third.
With Glanville, you always have to move in at third to take away the bunt possibility. And he loves to hit a first ball fastball. And Jose Hernandez, who had some problems defensively at shortstop in this series, has now moved back to the more familiar third base position.
So Glanville's set to go here, and so are the Cubs. Doug hitting 330 on the year, ninth in the National League, 6 homers and 27 runs batted in. And our first pitch of the summer is a strike call. Another huge crowd at Wrigley Field, well above 36,000-37,000 on hand today. And we'll see that for the Cleveland series too. Glanville, you see the third best average on the road, but he's down 2 quick strikes. Trachsel looking for his 7th win of the year. Steve, problem for him in his last 2 outings has been getting that third out.
Well, I think he wants to get ahead today with the wind blowing in and use that forkball.
Let's see if he uses it here. Missed outside, 2 balls, 2 strikes.
He wants to see just how far that outside corner will extend for Bill Hahn, who's behind the plate. Get a tough man to fan in Glanville. He usually puts a bat on the ball.
He did there, but fouled it away to stay alive. 2 balls and 2 strikes. Glanville, one of many Phillies who's just murdered Cub pitching. And that makes that man, Terry Francona, the Philly manager, very happy. He's done another good job with this Philadelphia team. A lot of young players that are going to get a lot better over time. One of them in the box. Again, Glanville hangs tough. Sammy, last night, yes indeed, was there. They were taking target practice. You guys bring your gloves today? You might need them. And Sosa has joined the home run chase with Mark McGwire. In the pursuit of Roger Maris, Glanville swings weakly, strikes out. Sandy will throw him out at first. And that's a good start.
But here's a man that's really hurt Steve Trachsel over the course of his career. He's had all kinds of problems with Jeffries. And there's the good curveball. Nice block by Sandy Martinez. He strikes out a man who's hard to strike out, and he's a good man to keep off base. But Jeffries' lifetime hitting .412 against Trachsel with a couple of home runs.
Jeffries, a switch hitting left fielder, hitting .316 on the year. And he looks at ball one.
And as we told you, Jeffries has just murdered Steve Trachsel. Be hard to get one out of here in right field today, however.
Squibbed off the end of the bat, foul, and the count evens at 1-1.
Trachsel's been very tough here at home, a 5-1 record. He had his 5-0 streak interrupted by Milwaukee last start. And in the series, Jeffries been pretty good.
Pop back our way, and just out of reach. It's 1-2. Father's Day means family day. They've even got the suntan lotion. Mom and Dad had them prepared today.
They're going to need it because it is a bright sunny day, and especially intense in the bleachers.
The 1-2. Slice toward left. On comes Henry. He misplays it. It rolls past him. That's big trouble. Jeffries around second on his way to third. Brown backing up the play. And Jeffries reaches third. It's a triple.
It's a good thing that Brant Brown was backing up, or that would have been an inside the park home run. And Henry probably would have been better served to just play this one on a hop. It was a sinking line drive. You know the wind's blowing in, or should know. And so you know that this one is probably going to get by you in this case. Henry just dives over it. That ball actually hit behind his glove, not in front of it. And Jeffries on his way to third.
And now you've got a very tough customer and Scott Rowland digging in. So the Phillies threatening in the top of the first. These guys are very, very tough against the Cubs. Rowland with 14 home runs on the year. Looks at strike one.
Their offense has been tough against everybody this year. They're second in the league behind Atlanta. They don't hit a lot of balls out of the park, but they do hit for a high average. 277, 4 points behind the Braves.
And they've been much better than that the last 2 weeks or so. Pitch. They've hit .311 as a team in the last 15 games. That's impressive.
This has been a good hitter series with the wind blowing out every day until today.
Runner at third, one out the pitch. Bill Hahn has not given that outside portion of the strike zone. Two balls and a strike.
No, I think Steve Trachsel thought that that one was pretty good. And now he knows if he's not going to get it a couple inches off the corner, he's going to have to make a readjustment.
Jeffries leads from third. The pitch popped him up. Mark Grayson, foul ground, has a play. He's got it. And that's the big second out. Well, you don't see Rowland fail to come through in a situation like that very often, but he becomes the second big out of the inning, and Jeffries stays at third.
This is a big out, and Mark Grace, knowing Jeffries was at third, gets the ball back in quickly, and Jeffries can't advance. So you have to dodge the one man that has consistently hurt the Cubs this year, Rico Bronya. I think the Cubs are pretty happy that this is the last time that they will have to contend yes. with these fighting Phils. They're 3-5 against them this year.
And Bronya has murdered pitching for the Cubs. 4-14 this year with 14 runs batted in. And he's done that in 7 games. The teams have played 8. He missed one of them. No balls at a strike to the Philadelphia first baseman. Bronya with 11 homers, 58 runs batted in.
Against Trachsel, Bronya hitting 333.
He falls behind, two balls and a strike.
Well, normally they have Lieberthal behind Bronya, so you might want to be careful with him and go to the right-hand hitter. But today, with Perrin playing, they have left-hand hitting Bobby Abreu behind Bronya.
Two and one. Three balls and a strike now.
I think if you keep this one up and away from Bronya, if he does swing at it, he'll probably hit it right at Henry. But you want to make sure you don't allow him to pull everything. He has a tendency to open up, especially when he's ahead of you.
Runner at third, two outs. The pitch. He walks him, first and third now. So Abreu comes in carrying an eight-game hit streak. He's hitting 326 with six homers and 32 batted in. Against the Cubs, he's hitting 433 this year. This guy's a terrific looking young prospect. Again, they got him from Tampa Bay for Kevin Stocker. Tampa Bay got him in the expansion draft from Houston.
Sammy moves over a few steps to guard the line in right because Abreu has been trying to pull everything.
There's your defensive alignment, and here's your first pitch to Abreu. It's a belt high strike.
Driving in runs with runners in scoring position, Bobby Abreu in this all-important category, fourth in the league.
Jeffries tripled with one out. Roland popped to first. Bronya walked on five pitches. And now Abreu behind in the count, nothing and one. A ball and a strike.
Well, it's not like the Braves needed any more good news than they've had most of this season, but they got a good piece of it last night when John Smoltz threw a brilliant game against Montreal in his comeback start. Seven innings, didn't give up any earned runs. And he won the ball game, and I think everybody associated with the Braves probably breathed a sigh of relief.
One and one. Hit hard and through the right side for a hit. Jeffries scores, and the Phillies take a 1-0 lead. Abreu continues to torture us here in Chicago.
RBI 33 for Bobby Abreu, who just reached out on that off-speed pitch and drove it through the right side. So the Phillies on top. This curveball stays out over the plate, and Abreu drives in the first run of the game.
And nine of the last 10 runs Traxel's given up have come with two outs in his last three starts. And he's not out of trouble here in the first inning. First and second, two down for Mark Lewis, their second baseman. He's hitting 220 on the year, lifetime, one for three against Steve. And he falls behind. One ball, no strikes.
Lewis had a couple of hits last night. And he likes to take the fastball the opposite way.
Pop back toward the press box to our right. And the fans battle for the Father's Day souvenir.
11 first inning runs, and this is 15th start. That's not all that bad, and it's not unusual that pitchers have problems early in the ball game before they tighten things up.
But seven of those 11 in the last three games for Steve, five of them against Minnesota. The 1-1. Now he's ahead 1-2. Houston hosts Cincinnati again. Pete Harnisch versus Pete Shurik at the Astrodome. They should be getting ready to start the ball game any minute now down in Texas. And scoreboard as well as the rest of the National and American League scores on this lovely Sunday afternoon. And Lewis stays alive. Padres win streak finally got snapped by the Giants yesterday, 5-2. Sean Estes, remember how rockily he started the year? He's won six of his last seven decisions now for San Francisco, but they are four and a half games out of first.
And how about Rob Nen with 22 saves? 18 of them, I believe, in a row. Putting together just a great season.
One ball, two strikes, the pitch. Snap throw back. It hits the base runner. And Bronya.
That didn't feel good.
Does not appreciate that. He's still down.
Well, you don't mind getting hit while you're hitting, but you don't expect to get hit while you're running the bases. This is not a good throw, and it gets Rico Bronya in the latissimus dorsi.
The what?
The latissimus dorsi. The lat. It doesn't feel good when it hits you there.
I don't think I have any of those, so that's why I was asking what it was. But I think he'll be okay. He'll stay in the game. Gets a little extra face time here on a Sunday afternoon. And the Phillies have the deuces wild now. Two balls, two strikes is your proper count. There are two outs. And it's a 1-0 Philadelphia game.
On a line drive into right field, Sammy will have a good shot at Bronya unless he gets a good jump off second.
Steve comes set. Now the pitch. Swing and a miss. And Lewis is retired. But the Phillies pick up a run on two hits. And they leave two stranded. After a half inning, Philadelphia won. The Cubs coming up. 1-0 our score after a half inning. Let's check out the Cubs starting lineup. As always brought to you by Pepsi, Brant Brown has had a great series against the Phillies. Mickey Morandini bats second. How about Sammy Sosa for the Cubs? Then it's Mark Grace, Henry Rodriguez, Jose Hernandez, Manny Alexander, Sandy Martinez, Steve Trachsel bats ninth.
And the defense for Terry Francona and the Phils, Jeffries, Glanville, Abreu left to right, Roland, Relaford, Lewis, and Bronya in the infield. A battery of the veteran Mark Parent and Tyler Green. He has walked far too many guys for the liking of Terry Francona. He's had some problems spotting the fastball, and Brant Brown, 2-for-2 lifetime against him.
And a home run cut and fouled away. Brant Brown is 8-for-13 in this series with four home runs.
Good knuckle curveball and a changeup has Tyler Green, and there is a knuckle curve. Now, when he has problems with control of either the knuckle curve or the fastball, which he has on occasion, he'll go to a lot of straight changes.
Bounced foul past Dan Radisson, who wasn't quick enough to make the play at first. It's 1-2.
Green, a big man at 6'5", 210 pounds. And he was the number one draft pick of the Phillies in 1991.
Strike three call. That might have been that knuckle curve. And Brown is retired for out number one.
In the last three starts, Green has had his problems. But this time, that knuckle curve just spins over the middle of the plate. And it's taken for a called third. Three starts ago, he walked 5 7 innings. Two starts ago, he walked 7 6 2/3 innings. Last time he gave up 7 runs in 5 innings.
Morandini almost got hit by a good live fastball. That's a way to say Happy Father's Day, and you can tell summer is here. The sailboats are gracing the waters of Lake Michigan, as well as the jet ski or two. Mickey takes strike one.
I thought being teammates, Tyler and Mickey would get along real well, but maybe that first pitch would indicate that they had some problems.
One ball, one strike. Hit to the right side, Lewis. Two down. Well, here's the man of the series for the Cubs, Sammy Sosa.
He gets a huge hand because of this. The first home run just barely made it. That was a two-run shot, but the second home run was hit a mile, hit the top of the middle house. And that middle house is 460-some feet away. That one probably would have gone 500 feet if it were unobstructed. And that's where he hit it, a bomb.
They need to move the sign to the right, though, a little more, if they wanted to be accurate as to where the ball actually hit. But that's still pretty close. An absolute bomb by Sosa, who's hit 29 homers 72 runs batted in 70 Cup games. As good as Sammy was playing before he injured his wrist, he's been even more unbelievable since resting that wrist against the Atlanta team. 1-2.
Well, yesterday they tried to come inside on him a couple times. That probably wasn't the place to go. I would expect today to see a steady diet of that knuckle curveball. And if he sees a fastball, it'll be either way in off the plate or they're going to try to get strikes away. And Sammy just four behind Big Mac.
One ball, two strikes. Had a monstrous cut and stays alive.
Well, Parent wanted it inside. He moved inside, but Tyler Green got it out over the plate and Sammy fouled it straight back. He was lucky the way Sammy's swinging to get away with that one.
One and two to Sammy. On the outside edge, took the fastball for strike three, and the inning is over. No runs, no hits, no errors, no one left. One inning complete. Phillies have a one-run lead. Playback today, we look back at how Sammy Sosa's month of June began. Sammy came back from a bad wrist to hit this bomb onto Waveland off the Marlins' Ryan Dempster. Then Oscar Henriquez became victim number two in June, and Sammy gets a two home run start to his eventual record-setting month. Sweet swinging Sammy Sosa, today's Discover Card Payback Playback. Well, we'll see Sammy hitting the bottom of the fourth inning, but first things first, got to take care of the Phillies in the top half, and Bobby Abreu in particular, who leads things off. And it's okay if you don't stay within the lines on this beautiful Father's Day. And it's a strike to Abreu. He's singled home. The game's only run back in the first inning. Abreu now with a 9-game hitting streak and 9 runs batted in during that span. You can see the pieces to the puzzle slowly being put together by this Philadelphia team. They've got their leadoff man in Glanville. They've got Roland and Bronya and Abreu. Lieberthal, their everyday catcher. Relaford may or may not be their shortstop. Marlon Anderson, a terrific young infield prospect, being groomed for second base perhaps as early as next year. And then Schilling and Lower. And some of these other Philadelphia pitchers start to settle in. It's going to be a tough team to contend with. Cubs have found that out this year. They have played very well against us.
Even with a win today, the Cubs will lose the season series, but obviously this is a big one for the Cubs as they keep watching that scoreboard in the Cincinnati-Houston game.
Abreu sends a drive toward left. Henry nearing the line. Puts it away for out number one. Cincinnati and Houston scoreless after two down at the Dome. And Trachsel's now set down five in a row. Mark Lewis, who struck out to end the first, now bats for the Philadelphia team. He swings at the first ball and fouls it away. It's 0-1.
Looks like both teams kind of feeling the effects of what's been a long and an offensive series. And today, instead of the wind blowing out, the wind is blowing in, and there's only been two hits combined between these two clubs.
And when it is blowing like that, you hope you're the team that scores first, but unfortunately for Cubs fans, that hasn't happened. It's Philadelphia with the one-run lead. And Tyler Green has been very, very tough to handle so far. But it is early. We're just in the fourth inning. Too short. And he can't handle it.
That will probably be an error, but we'll take a look and wait and see. Manny had just one step to his left and then bobbled the ball. He's there. He just misses it.
That's got to be an error. But it scored a hit. And the crowd can't. Well, that's got to be an error.
Christmas comes early for Mark Lewis.
Wow, ball hit right to the guy's left. And He flat out missed it. That's a hit.
Here's the original good man for two, Mark Parent.
The runner goes. He chops the ball to the left side. They try to keep out of the double play. They will. As Parent's retired, Gray snaps a throw back to second and just not in time.
Well, Lewis had a pretty good idea that he was going to go to third base on that throw. He rounded the bag and Mark Grace went behind him, and Lewis puts on the brakes, and I think he hurt himself. You saw that right leg give out. He just barely gets back in ahead of the tag, and he's still feeling the effects of that quick step.
So he stands at second with two outs now, and Relaford, the shortstop, is the Philly hitter.
So you want to be careful with Relaford. Even though Green is a pretty good hitting pitcher, he still hits right-handed, and you still have the advantage over him if you're Steve Trachsel.
And again, the way he's pitching and the way the wind's blowing, a second run would be very, very big. Strike one. Lewis, a very big lead from second. And the count evens at a ball and a strike. Phillies hopeful of getting Ricky Pitalico and Ken Ryan back. Both of them very good relief pitchers. Both of them on the disabled list. Both of them had arm problems.
If they do get Pitalico back, and if he shows what he showed last year, then Mark Leiter becomes expendable. And they could use Mark Leiter to probably get a young player or two in return, because there's going to be a lot of teams very interested in him, especially from what he's shown as a closer out of their bullpen.
Pete Tomar, ace Philly insider, tells us that Pitalico has been making some minor league rehab starts, but hasn't quite rediscovered the zip on his fastball, at least the zip that the Phillies were accustomed to seeing. But they're hopeful he'll get that back. The 1-2. A check swing roller, foul, and Relaford stays alive.
Good fastball high and away to Relaford, a lot like Bronian. You'll probably catch a young hitter expanding that strike zone. He can't catch up to it up there. And Henry wisely playing shallow and over toward the line in left.
One ball, two strikes. Trachsel very deliberate with runners aboard. And now time called. He and Sandy want to get together on the signs. How about the Yankees yesterday? They became the first team in the big leagues to win 50 ball games. They and Atlanta, the only two teams in the majors that have won a half century number so far. Wells, 8 innings, 9 strikeouts, no walks, as the Yankees beat the Indians 5-3 yesterday. And then the Braves, as Steve mentioned earlier, behind John Smoltz, matched the Yankees 50 win total behind Smoltz's arm in a 5-1 win. The Yankees having just an unbelievable year. They're doing it without Bernie Williams. They got Derek Jeter, their fine shortstop, back 2 games ago. And they just keep on rolling along at a 746 winning percentage. That's incredible. The 2-2. Now it's full 3-2 with the pitcher due next.
See, New York with a 9-game lead over Boston, and Boston is playing great baseball, but they're in danger of falling out of it. Even the year that Detroit in 1984 went 35-5 to start the season, their record wasn't as good as New York's is now.
Rifled over second into right field for a hit. Sammy comes up, drops it. There'll be no play. Lewis scores. It's 2-0.
Well, Sammy wasn't going to get Lewis anyway, and that fastball was on the inner portion, and it turns into a run. You hate to see that with a right-hand hitting pitcher coming up to the eighth hitter, but Relaford drives in his 17th run of the year. The Cubs fall down by 2. And you can see Relaford drives this ball into right field. Sammy was coming up throwing, but he wasn't going to get Lewis, who got a very good jump off second base, and he scores with no play.
So the gift hit, which should have been an error, results in a Philadelphia run as Relaford drives home his 17th of the year. And it's 2-0 Phillies, and the pitcher bats and takes ball one. Again, two out trouble for Trachsel. 10 of the last 11 runs now he's given up, have been with two men out. One ball, no strikes. Off the pitcher's body to even the count. Well, the Phillies say this guy Green has been a tease for them, and that some days he'll look like he's got Cy Young stuff. Other days, he has nothing at all. Today, it looks like he's got his good game going. He has struck out five of the first nine Cubs he's faced. Two balls and a strike.
A couple years back, he did make the All-Star team, having a great first half. But he had some arm problems after that. They've always known, after picking him number one, that he's had good enough stuff to be successful, but physically he's been hampered somewhat, and control has always been a problem. The year he made the All-Star team, he was 8-4 making the All-Star team. And then he just disintegrated the second half of the year, 0-5 with an ERA over 8.
Two balls, two strikes. Got him swinging. And that retires the side. Trachsel has struck out 6 through 4, but two out RBIs have him trailing 2-0. 2-0 after 3.5. Two out RBI hits by the Phillies, one of them by the number 8 hitter. Has cost Steve Trachsel a 2-0 lead here, but it's the top of the Cub order. Hopefully the second time through will be much more profitable against right-hander Tyler Green, who's faced the minimum through three. He has struck out 5, walked 2. The Cubs yet to record a hit.
Well, it's time to break up the no-hitter right here. It's going to either be Brown or Morandini. We'll see who gets the best pitch first.
2-0.
But you can't hit me if I hit you first.
That's exactly right. That missed. 3-0. Esteban Loaiza of the Pirates has a perfect game through four innings in Milwaukee. He's got a 7-0 lead, by the way. A 3-0 to Brown, taking all the way. 3-1.
He was moved back into the starting rotation when Jose Silva broke his hand trying to bunt.
Against this guy.
Against this very same guy.
3-2.
Cub-esque, isn't it?
No. So don't go up there bunting. Bad things could happen. The 3-2. Popped him up out of play. Headed over the rooftops.
Right on the top of Ron Santo's car.
He would not be real happy if that were to happen again. Earlier this year, Santo had the back windshield of his car busted by a foul ball. The pitch. He just did stay alive, did Brownie? It's still 3-2.
Grant getting some great cuts. And the key to his year has been the opportunity to play every day. And he also started against the left-hander, Matt Beach, yesterday and responded with a perfect night. Grant Brown really coming of age right before our eyes.
The payoff pitch. He walks. Well, the Cubs have had a couple of base runners in this game, but they haven't exactly dazzled anybody with their base running acumen so far.
See, Green knew that the no-hitter was going to go by the boards. That's why he walked Brownie.
Well, it better happen against this guy. Otherwise, your title as Nostradamus Jr. is in serious jeopardy. Mickey grounded out his first time. is 3-for-10 in the series. And Brown back at first standing up. Brandt has stolen 3 bases in 7 tries. And a swing and a miss. We welcome the Indians to town tomorrow night. A brief 2-game series against the first place team in the AL Central. Doc Gooden and Charles Nagy will face us Monday night, then Tuesday. Then it's off to Detroit for a couple of games.
There's the matchups. Fortunately, we will not see Bartolo Colon, nor will we see Jarrett Wright. That's always an advantage when you're playing the Tribe.
The 1-1. Breaking ball beaten towards second. Lewis to short. One on the first. In time double play.
Well, good play by Relaford turning two. Brandt Brown got down the line in a hurry. Came down to take a piece out of Relaford, but he turned it perfectly, and Mickey has grounded into the 4-6-3 double play. Watch it again. Good throw by Lewis. Brown bearing down on Relaford, who goes up and over and throws it perfectly.
So here Sosa took a fastball for strike three. And another look at Lewis to Relaford to Bronya. Here's Sammy. And the first pitch is over for strike one. Here's a look at our ComEd Power Profile.
And the ComEd Power Profile is Sammy Sosa, as you would expect, who has been doing just about everything right. His first 39 games, he did pretty well. The next 21, he has unloaded. 20 home runs. The batting average stayed the same. And that is today's ComEd Power Profile.
The 0-2 pitch. That was the strikeout pitch, and he thought he had it.
That was the exact same pitch the first time up. Only this time, it was ball one and not strike three. Well, if I'm Tyler Green, I go out there again.
That's where they set up. And Sammy fouls it off the end of the bat.
Amazingly, Cleveland has the best pitching in the American League. We hear a lot about the Indians hitting, and justifiably so. It's a very powerful club, but they're pitching number one ahead of the Yankees.
Well, you got Burba, you've got Wright, you've got Colon. And then Doc Gooden, Charles Nagy, who's 7-3. Their pitching's not as bad as everybody thought it was going to be. The pitch is outside, 2-2. Boy, they can hit. Those guys can flat out hit the baseball with Tomey and Alomar and Justice and Ramirez and Kenny Lofton back. Should be a great 2-game series. It's sold out, the 2-2. Is pop back out of play.
Mark Parent wants the ball inside, and Tyler Green can't get himself to get it there. He keeps on throwing it away from Sammy, which is probably a wise choice. And Mark telling him, keep that shoulder in. You're flying open, and that's why you are losing that pinpoint control. Here's the change.
Sammy hits it a ton. Deep toward right. She's got to be long gone.
You don't want to change up on Sammy Sosa. And for the 21st time in 22 games, Sammy Sosa has left the ballpark. His 30th. RBI 73. It's a 2-1 game. And wind blowing in, wind blowing out, it makes no difference whatsoever. That changeup out over the plate, and Sammy rifled it.
There goes your no-hitter. There goes your shutout. Now it's a 2-1 game, and maybe that'll wake up the bat rack. Here's Grace. He takes ball one. The crowd wants the curtain call. Sosa, 30 home runs for the Cubs.
With that home run, he ties the National League record all time for home runs in a month. That's home run number 17. That ties Willie Mays. And it went 376 happy feet.
Grace grounds out to Bronia to retire the Cubs in the fourth. But Sammy Sosa's 30th home run, his 17th of the month, and his 21st in 21 games, makes it a 2-1 Philadelphia game. For Sammy Sosa, it's now a 2-1 game in favor of the Phillies after four.
Pitch to him at your peril, National League pitchers, because Sammy just waited back on the changeup. Used to be able to change up on it. You can't do it anymore.
Hit on the ground towards second. And there's one away. Glanville's 0 for 3. And I like your chances without having that guy on base. Now Jeffries hits. And it's a great day for a little ice cream, a little lemonade, and even a little chocolate pudding, which is what I think that youngster had going on here at Wrigley Field. Jeffries has scored one of the two Philly runs. He tripled in the first. And Trachsel changes up on him. Nothing in one.
Now, where is Summerlin, your little daughter, going to take you for Father's Day?
I don't know. I wouldn't mind just staying home and having a nice home-cooked meal. Don't get many of those.
I know she has some squashed bananas and pureed peas for
absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. I don't like the peas. The squash is okay. The bananas are fine. But the peas are off limits. She likes them, though. She likes sweet potatoes. And she likes to wear them as she eats them. No balls, two strikes to Jeffries. And Steve tries to paint the outside edge.
Houston has scored a run in the bottom of the third, and they lead Cincinnati 1-0.
One and two. Squibb toward third. Jose, backhand stab, throws to first in time. Two down. One more note on Sosa. No Cub until this season had ever had a stretch of hitting 10 home runs in 9 games. With the home run Sammy just hit, not only has he done that again, it's the second time he's done that this year.
Well, before this year, the fastest any Cub had hit 10 home runs was in a 16-game span. Sammy's done it twice in the same year. And we have a long way to go, not only in this month, but in this game. He's also creeping up on Big Mac, only 3 back.
Scott Rowland hits with the bases clear and 2 outs. And he pulls that ball a tongue foul. 0-1.
Well, you hear a whole lot about Mark McGwire not wanting the attention. Maybe not taking batting practice because there's no reason to make the fans happy around the league. Sammy is still going to take batting practice, and he's getting awfully close to the big man.
It's 1-1. But you know the questions are inevitably going to start for Sosa now. And it'll be fun to see how he deals with all of the attention and all the accolades that come with hitting so many home runs. And he's right in the hunt with Griffey, with McGwire, in the chase for Roger Maris and the 61 or better home run total.
Well, Sammy has said all year long, it's very simple. I have some guys around me now in the lineup who can hit. So I'm seeing better pitches because they don't want to walk me and get to them. But Sammy's also been much more selective. He's always been capable of putting up huge home run totals, but he's always fanned a lot,
right,
and he's always walked very few times. That batting average has always been down in the 260s. Now the batting average is in the 330s.
Rowland is issued a 2-out walk. And up to date, the home run race at the moment. Sosa with 30, McGwire 33. Roger Maris at this point in 61 had only 28. And you're right. I think the big key for Sammy has been his patience at the plate. He's always going to strike out a lot. But when you figure in last year, the man only walked 45 times. And he's walked 33 times already, and we're not through the month of June. That says a lot about how he's matured as a hitter.
Another factor about both of these hitters, both McGwire and Sammy hitting over 300 this year.
That's really amazing. It's
pretty good.
Here's Bronia. One ball, no strikes.
Sammy, with every home run now, sets or ties a record, the National League mark, by the inimitable Willie Mays, 17 back in August of 65.
I can't wait to see Sammy taking shots at that right field pavilion in Tiger Stadium. That overhang in the upper deck.
In the left field pavilion. You can take him out easily both ways. That is a nice place to hit home runs.
The pitchers will not enjoy the trip to Motor City as much as the hitters, perhaps. 1-0 is your count. Are you going to bring a glove?
You can get some nasty foul balls back at Tiger Stadium.
Someone once told me, and I think it's true, that you are sitting closer to home plate in the broadcasting booth at Tiger Stadium than the pitcher is to the hitter.
Oh, that's just dandy.
We'll test those cat-like reflexes.
I've done a game or two there, however.
Two balls, no strikes.
Arnie was there, took some vicious line drives off the truck.
The pitch is rifled foul. Well, Ty Cobb was still playing when Arnie was first there. 2-1. The historic ballpark at the corner of Michigan and Trumbull. Over the next 10 days, the Cubs will host the Indians for the first time ever. We'll go to Detroit for the first time since, well, we don't want to mention what happened in 45. We'll go to Kansas City. Oh, what a great city Kansas City is, and a beautiful ballpark.
First time since 1886. And they'll host the Diamondbacks for the first time ever. I wonder if the Gates brothers' ribs were still there in 1886. Or Arthur Bryant.
Strouds. Oh, you got my mouth watering just thinking about it.
I do love barbecue.
Ooh. Somebody's got to make sure we get a couple of slabs of ribs for the trip home. From our good friends at Gates. Ah, those pickles and the barbecue sauce. Ah, what a way to head home after what we hope will be a very successful road trip. The 2-1. Another great spot is Stroud's, man. Ooh, great fried chicken, mashed potatoes. Great eating town, and I can eat. You know that.
No doubt about that.
Three balls and a strike to Rico Bronya. Steve's got to polish these guys off.
You just have trouble paying. You have no trouble eating.
Oh, that's not true. The pitch. Runner goes. It's outside ball four.
And Manny had to block that one because on ball four. Manny took a shot when he tried to stop that ball from going into center field. Watch it again as
Sandy with a laser beam.
Well, Sandy can't umpire. He doesn't know what the call is going to be. And Manny took this one right off the wrist. Not a particularly good throw, but it is a painful experience for Manny Alexander.
But he did keep the ball in front of him, and Steve's two-out troubles continue. It's amazing. He's worked just one 1-2-3 inning. That was back in the third. And you've got Abreu, who's killed the Cubs all year long, standing in. He drove in the first run with a two-out single back in the first.
Well, you'd like to try to force him to hit the ball to left field by keeping the ball away, because he's going to be trying to pull it.
And he's strong enough to test the wind, and a swinging bunt is foul. 0-1. Travis Lee of the Diamondbacks just hit a solo home run to tie the game in St. Louis at 1-1 off Curtis King.
Travis Lee probably is going to be the number one competition for Kerry Wood in the battle for Rookie of the Year. It's shaping up like it might come down between those two guys, although there are some very good young players around. Those two seem to stand out.
No balls, one strike. Abreu rifles the ball to the gap in left center field. One run's going to score for sure. Bronya around second. He's on his way to third. He's going to be waved. Here comes Manny's relay throw to the plate. It's not in time. And Abreu does it again. He doubles home two more runs with two outs, and Trachsel just can't seem to polish anybody off. All four runs have scored with two men down in the game.
Bobby Abreu continues to just murder Cub pitching. He's now driven in 35-3 today. He's 2-for-3. And the Cubs will be very happy not to see him anymore. This is a fork ball. It's out away from Abreu, and he can catch up to it because it's down. And he just drives it into the gap. And the two walks have come back to haunt Trachsel as the Cubs now trail by three at 4-1, and the bullpen up and going for the first time, and I think it's Dave Stevens.
22 doubles for Abreu on the year. And it's now a 4-1 game, and the momentum swiftly shifts back into Philadelphia's favor here. Cubs had cut the lead in half to 2-1 now. Two walks with two outs, then a double to Abreu. And indeed it is Dave Stevens warming up. And Phil Regan, the Cubs pitching coach, on his way out. Steve, as a pitcher, what happens to you when you get that second out? And what do you see happening to Steve in his last three starts that's given him so much trouble in trying to finish off an inning?
I don't think there's any one thing you can point to. I think you just have to take it pitch by pitch. But he got a little too careful to both Rolen and Bronya. And knowing that Abreu is a deadly low ball hitter, I'm not sure if the fork ball is the pitch you wanted to go to, because even if you throw a good one, it still has to go down. And if you have a good low ball hitter, that's where he wants it. If you keep that fastball up and away, that's where Abreu has some problems. And he's just been so hot against the Cubs that he's hitting most everything.
So tip your cap to him. Now Lewis batting. And after the meeting, he misses again to Steve. Two balls, no strikes. Phillies 4, Cubs 1. We're in the fifth. It's 3-0.
Last night in one of the battles that Kerry Wood had early against Abreu, he threw him a very good slider, but it went low and in. And Abreu just opened up. It was a low pitch, and he rifled it down the line for a double. And he just loves the ball down.
Another walk. That's five of those. First and second, two out.
That's going to be it for Steve Trachsel, and he's going to leave a very disappointed young man.
Steve works 4 2/3 innings, five walks. He struck out six. Has given up four runs. And the runners at first and second belong to him. So Dave Stevens on here in the fifth. It's Phillies 4, Cubs 1. Back with more in a moment. Pedro Valdez will pinch hit for Dave Stevens here for the Cubs, who lead off the sixth inning down 4-1. Valdez came up from AAA Iowa after Kevin Foster was sent back down. Valdez had a great year going. He's just 24 years old.
And he's a good hitter.
Sprays the ball foul out of play. Two balls and a strike.
I'll tell you where he has a lot of power. That's the left center field. And with that in mind, Doug Glanville has moved over a couple of steps, and they shade him that way, trying to take away the gap.
The 2-1. Hit hard, but right to Bronya in a catcher's crouch. One down. So Valdez retired. Now back to the top of the order we go for the Cubs and Brant Brown.
We'd like to see somebody on base when Sammy Sosa comes to bat again. And so either Brown or Brown and Morandini would love to get on ahead of Sosa.
Finals in from the American League. Kansas City beats Detroit 6-5. Hippolyto Pichardo picks up the victory. Boston beats Tampa Bay 3-1. Pedro Martinez was scintillating today. He really struggled four or five starts ago, but today held the Devil Rays to one run on two hits and wins the game 3-1. Brown falls behind 0-2. How about Mike Morgan? Just down the road a piece at Comiskey Park, Minnesota's beating the White Sox 6-0. Mike Morgan has thrown a three-hit shutout in that game. He's thrown 78 pitches through seven innings.
Well, Morgan showed the Cubs that he still has plenty left, because he threw a very good game against them in Minnesota. And Bob Patterson will come into this game.
1-2 to Brown, misses. Two balls, two strikes. Elsewhere in the American, Toronto over Baltimore 7-3. Ed Sprague just hit a solo home run in the ninth inning. Baltimore just can't put it together. The 2-2. Off the end of the bat, up the middle. Lewis to his right, can't make the play.
That'll be a base hit. There hasn't been much that stuck in Lewis's glove in this series. But that was a tough play. And Brant Brown has his first hit of the day. This one, driven right by Tyler Green. And it bounces out of Lewis's glove.
And let's see if Mickey can hit it somewhere other than second base this time. He's grounded to second and hit a rocket to Lewis, who started the 4-6-3 double play back in the fourth inning. One on, one out. Cubs down 4-1. The pitch. Hit hard and threw a right side hit. Sosa will bat and represent the tying run.
See if maybe Galen Sisco comes out to talk to Tyler Green about how they want him to work. To the hottest hitter in all of baseball, Sammy Sosa. He got a changeup last time, and he just ripped it out of the ballpark in right field for the only Cub run.
All right, guys, in that pink house down the left field line, get your gloves out, because hopefully here comes Sammy. 4-1, two on, one out. Ball one. The Cubs had two hits through five innings. They've got two hits in the sixth alone. Hit hard and threw a left side hit. Brown round third. He'll run on Jeffries. Here comes the relay. It's not in time. Single for Sosa makes it 4-2. He's doing it all, folks.
And they might have waited a little too long to get somebody loose in that pen, because Tyler Green has averaged just a little over five innings per start. So in this, the sixth inning, the Cubs have hit the ball pretty hard, and Sammy, with RBI number 74, drives it into left field. And now here comes Galen Sisco, as the bullpen has just started to work. No chance to get Brownie on that one. And the Cubs trail by only two.
And Mark Grace, Henry Rodriguez, Jose Hernandez, the scheduled hitters. It's a 4-2 game here at Wrigley Field. As the meeting continues, we'll remind you our senior producer director of Cubs baseball is Arnie Harris. Today's game produced by Pete Toma. Our associate producer is Mark Brady. Kim Fields is our coordinating producer. The executive producer of WGN Sports is Bob Vorwald, and our booth assistant, our AD, is the lovely and talented Kathy Kerr here at Wrigley Field.
Looks like Spradlin and Perez up in the bullpen for the Phillies. You got the left-hander on the right and the right-hander on the left.
So here's Mark Grace. He's 0-1 with a walk. Two on, one in, one out. And he almost got hit. One ball, no strikes. Boy, what a happy Father's Day this could be if the Cubs could come back from a 4-1 hole and beat the Phillies on a gorgeous afternoon at Wrigley Field. He's taken all the way, 2-0. Two balls, no strikes, a hitter's pitch. He rifles it into the seats, foul, and out of play. 2-1. Marks 1-for-6 lifetime against Mr. Green. He looks for his fifth hit of the series. You've got good speed aboard in front of Grace. If he could split the gap in left, two runs might be able to score. The pitch. 2-2. Mark Parrott almost looks too big for that chest protector, doesn't he? That thing's awful snug on Mark Parrott. He's a big man. The 2-2. Full count now, three balls, two strikes.
Well, now you can think about sending the runners, try to stay out of the double play, because Mark Grace very rarely strikes out. And so let's see what Riggs, with one out, has in mind.
3-2, the runners lead from first and second. They are going to pitch. Ball four, wild pitch. Bases are loaded, no advance. And still only one out.
Tyler Green has lost it in a hurry here in the sixth inning. And we'll see how patient Terry Francona is with it. This one getting by Mark Parent. But with the runners going, there is no advance beyond third base. So the base is loaded for Henry. Kerry Wood fanned 11 and hit a home run. Got his seventh win last night.
So here's Henry. He has struck out twice. He looks low. A walk means a run. With one of the hottest Cub hitters waiting on deck.
And Henry has the only grand slam of the year for the Cubs. The only grand slam in a couple of years for the Cubs.
The base is loaded in a 4-2 Philly game. The pitch swung on and pulled foul. Steve Trachsel was chased for the Cubs. The Phillies scored four runs against him. Dave Stevens has worked an inning and a third of spotless relief. Now the Cub pen. We'll try to keep on holding him, but the offense has got to come through here to try to at least tie it. The pitch swung on, popped up. Will it get to the seats?
Yes.
Thank goodness. It's 1-2, though.
Well, the knuckle curveball has been baffling Henry all day. But a lot of those knuckle curves wind up in the dirt, so a lot of pressure on Mark Parent behind the plate. Henry has only grounded into one double play all year.
So that's encouraging. You just hope he can make contact here. A fly ball would mean a run. The 1-2. Steve, right three. And now it's up to Jose if the Cubs are to score another run here.
There is the knuckle curve. And Greg, Billy Hahn says it's good enough. Henry thought it was up, but for the third time today, Henry has no contact. But probably the second hottest hitter on the ball club, Jose Hernandez, comes up.
And he extended his hitting streak to 10 games last time up. Don't need a home run, we'll certainly take it, but a base hit would tie the game, you'd think. Morandini at third. Sammy's at second. Mark Grace at first. It's a 4-2 Philadelphia game in the sixth. But a long way to go in this one. He takes strike one.
Well, the one fastball that Jose saw away, he drilled it into right field. And with Lewis playing pretty much up the middle, there is some room on that right side.
No balls, one strike. That stayed high. Jose is 6-for-18 in the series. And a key spot here. 1-1. Backs away. Two balls and a strike.
And Cincinnati has tied up Houston. So some good news on the horizon. And a base hit here would look awfully good for the Cubs.
Two balls, one strike. Here it is. Strike two on the outside edge. Jose not too sure. It's 2-2.
Well, this becomes the biggest pitch of the ball game for Tyler Green. Because if you go to 3-2, the runners are going with it. So you want to make it happen on the 2-2 pitch. And you
base
have to think it'd be the knuckle curve.
Let's see if he gets it. The pitch. High pop down the right side. Bronya gives chase over near the Philly bullpen, and he runs out of room. Cincinnati 1, Houston 1 in the bottom of the sixth inning at the Astrodome in Houston, Texas. Arizona beating the Cardinals 4-2 after 6 in St. Louis. Milwaukee losing at home to the Pirates 8-2. Montreal already beat Atlanta 4-1.
Mickey Morandini has to be coming down the line aggressively with the pitch, kind of anticipating something in the dirt that might get away.
Two balls, two strikes. Again, the runners lead the pitch. Foul back to the screen.
What a good cut on a fastball, and Jose was right on it.
Green's gotten that outside corner with the regular fastball. But you're right, the out pitch has been that knuckle curve. Two and two. Here it is. In the dirt. So now the runners will go. It's three and two. And a nice block by Parrott behind the plate. For a big man, he moves real well behind the dish.
Well, you knew eventually Green would have to go the knuckle curve, and many of them wind up in the dirt. So the merry-go-round will begin. And this is where anything in the gap scores three and gives the Cubs the lead.
The big crowd wants to see a hit. Three balls, two strikes. Huge leads by all three runners. They go. The pitch. Swing and a miss. He's struck him out. And the side is retired. Green has struck out a season high, tying 10. The Cubs settle for one in the sixth to make it a 4-2 game. Pedro Valdez stays in the game. He plays left field for the Cubs. Bob Patterson takes over on the mound and becomes the third Cub pitcher here in the top of the seventh inning.
Patterson 1-0, the ERA 5.40, on for the 25th time. He has to go right through the heart of the order. Roland, Bronya, and Abreu, if anybody gets on Lewis.
What did Jose strike out on?
A straight change on a 3-2 pitch. You see the bottom fall out of it. It is ball four, but just credit Tyler Green with 10 strikeouts today, pitching out of a real tough jam in the sixth. And I don't know how much more he's got left in the tank, but he got out of the jam there.
So it is Roland, Bronya, and Abreu. A 4-2 game. Green has been very impressive. And Patterson's first pitch is over for strike one. Marlins failed to score with the bases loaded in the eighth. They now have a runner aboard in the ninth, trailing the Mets 3-2. Milwaukee starting to come back. It's 8-4 in favor of the Pirates as they go to the top of the ninth. 1-1. Two balls and a strike from Bob.
Pretty good job of pitching by Dave Stevens in relief of Steve Trachsel. He went an inning and a third, gave up a hit, and that was it. And pitched out of a man at second, nobody out situation in the sixth inning to keep the Phillies at four.
Fisted out of play, 2-2. Phillies scored a single run in the first, a single run in the fourth, and then two-out walks in the fifth, followed by the Abreu double, made it 4-1 in favor of the Phillies. The Cubs added a run last half inning and trail it by two. And that's lined into right over Mark Grace's head. A leadoff single for Scott Rowland and the Phillies in the seventh. And this one of those days where you hope the curse of the seventh inning won't prove to be true. For not only are the Phillies already leading in the game, but we can't wait to hear Jimmy Buffett conduct the seventh inning stretch.
Against some left-handers, Rico Bronya will bunt. So Jose Hernandez at third doesn't want to get too deep. Now Mark Pechota is loosening up in the pen.
That pitch misses high. 1-0 from Patterson. Bronya struggles against lefties.
And that's why you would think he would be thinking about the bunt, perhaps, with Jose three steps back at third.
Upstairs. Well, a very special day today, always Father's Day. The father of the year in the state of Illinois, Willie Anderson, and his daughter Misty. Grandfather of the year, Don Pecho, and his grandson Jason Camosa. Stepfather of the year, Gregory Crowther, and stepdaughter Crystal Richardson. Father figure of the year, Mark Schubert and Larry Goggin. The annual contest sponsored by the Illinois Fatherhood Initiative. 41,000 kids across the state nominated a dad for the Father of the Year honors. So congratulations to today's guests and winners. And happy Father's Day to you as well. If you're watching and you are a papa, Two balls and a strike, two. Rico Bronya, the media relations department, wants to wish their dads a happy Father's Day. Louis Panazzo, Henry Wasserstrom, Domingo De La Fuente, and George Newby. Hopefully they're watching the game today. And the pitch outside, three balls and a strike to Bronya.
I know that Bob will be keeping a close eye on Scott Rowland, who has pretty good speed for a big man.
The 3-1, runner goes, popped up, back our way. But I don't think we'll have a play, nor will Sandy. He will not, so it's 3-2. Sharon Panazzo also wants to wish a very happy 80th birthday today to Bud Salk. Watching today's Phillies-Cubs matchup.
Rowland was running on the 3-1 pitch. You figure he'll be going on the 3-2 pitch, so you might get a chance for a strike him out, throw him out.
Rowland 6 of 9 in steals. Bronya has walked twice and struck out once. He's going. The pitch is outside, ball four. That's the sixth walk the Cubs have given the Phillies in today's game. First and second, now nobody out. Not a very fortuitous way to start the seventh. And now Abreu, the hitter. Abreu has single doubled. He's knocked in three runs and is also flied out to left.
Bob is probably in for his last hitter. Peixota will come in with Lewis and Parent due up after Abreu.
Bad news down in Houston. The Astros have scored two more runs. They lead 3-1 in the sixth inning over the Reds. So more trouble in the seventh, already down 4-2. And that's ball one from Bob.
Ray, who has grounded into four double plays this year, so it can be done, and what a series he's had.
Man.
Responsible for three of the four runs driven in today.
Two and oh.
Here comes Phil Regan. He wants to try to settle down Bob Patterson before this thing gets out of hand.
Mets finally finish off the Marlins. 3-2 is the final. Al Leiter wins again for New York. Boy, he's having an unbelievable year.
He was close to the league lead in ERA. He's either one or two.
Let's see what he finished up with today's play and our next telecast of Cubs baseball on WGN Thursday from Tiger Stadium, Michigan and Trumbull, and that grand old ballpark in downtown Motor City. Thursday, 6 o'clock Central, as interleague play once again for the Cubs, this time on the road. Then it's off to Kansas City for three over the weekend.
Well, if you're Abreu here, you're looking for a fastball because you got a pitcher struggling with his control, and you figure you're going to get one, and most likely it's going to be away.
Two balls, no strikes. Rifled into right center field. That's going to drop. Rowland rounds third. He's going to score. Bronya moves from second to third. It's now a 5-2 game, and Abreu, they're going to have to drag him out of Chicago kicking and screaming. He's knocked in four runs today.
Bobby Abreu has been a one-man gang. He now has driven in 36. He's 3-for-4. Each base hit has driven in one. He's looking for something out over the plate. He drives it in to right center field. That's going to be it for Patterson. On comes Mark Peixota as the Phillies threatening to blow it open here in the seventh. And once again, the curse of the top of the seventh that never seems to end.
Hopefully this inning will, however, in the not too distant future. 5-2 our score. We'll see how Peixota fares after this. This is Peixota here in the seventh inning. Bob Patterson faced three men. All three of them reached. One run has scored. And now Peixota tries to subdue the Phillies, who have a three-run lead now.
And Mark Peixota comes into this one. 0-1, a 4.04 ERA on for the 36th time. And there you look at the numbers. He'll deal with Lewis, Parent, and maybe Relaford if nobody grounds into a double play. The play you really like to see here, or have seen on occasion, is whoever is hitting, bunt up the right side, you score the run, you move the man to second base. And you got to figure the infield is going to be in, but if you make a good enough bunt, you can still get him home. One of the members of our crew, Mark Clausen, has his family at the ballpark today, and there are the Clausens.
And our thanks, as always, to the crew for a job well done. Outstanding work here at Wrigley Field. On our first day of summer, Lewis takes high and tight from Pesciotta. One ball, no strikes.
Lewis has a couple of sacrifice flies this year, but no sacrifice bunts.
First and third, nobody out. And now Lewis receives time. Houston still batting in the sixth, leading Cincinnati 3-1. So if that score stays the same, as does this one, the Cubs would be four out of first. Hit toward a second. The Cubs are coming home. Rolling. Heat Martinez. One out. Rico Bronya is retired at the plate. On the fielder's choice. 4-2.
Well, you're at the point of the ball game where you're not going to concede the run to get the double play. And this throw right there, the ball waiting for Bronya to arrive, and he's tagged out by Sandy Martinez. Heads up play by Morandini. And you get the out. Good block of the plate by Sandy.
Well, he's not afraid to stick his leg and his body out in front of that dish, is he?
No, he's done that all year.
So now you get the first out, and Parrott an inviting double play candidate here. Mark's 0 for 3 today. It's 5-2 Phillies. Well, Jimmy Buffett, I can just feel the presence. I can feel the ocean breeze and the wonderful songs and the pina coladas.
And you're looking a lot like a parrot head today.
I always have been. I've been told I look like a lot of things, but that not one of them. One ball, no strikes. Way out in front. You know, it's amazing. You look at Mark Parrott down on the field. From our vantage point, the players look about the same size. You go stand next to this guy, he is huge.
Yes, indeed. 6'5". I think they're underestimating that 245, however.
A lot of polyesters gave their lives for that particular Philadelphia uniform. Sandy, a good block. And it's 2-1.
Martinez able to keep the ball in front of him for the moment. He can't locate it, but Abreu doesn't know that. So as he overruns it, Bobby stays at second.
Two balls and a strike. The wind almost a non-factor right now at the ballpark. And now Pesciotta ready. The 2-1. Hit high in the air toward right, but it'll drift into the seats. 2-2 is your count. Final game of the year against the Phillies, and that's good news. Wonder if these guys play the Astros this tough.
They can't leave too soon as far as the Cubs are concerned.
Houston took 2 out of 3 against them earlier this year, but they've got to play them several more times. They are, however, the Phillies, finished with the Cardinals. They went 3-6 against St. Louis. Two balls, two strikes. It's full now, 3-2.
Well, I'm not sure if you'd risk running the base runners, but if you get the strikeout, you might rather go to second base on the throw as opposed to trying to cut down Abreu at third. Many times you'll go after the trailer who might not be running quite as hard.
The payoff pitch. Runners not going. It is ball 4.
Well, that's something you didn't want to see because Parent has not been swinging the bat real well, but the man coming up has, and that's Desi Relliford.
Abreu to third, Lewis to second, Parent to first. And you're right, Relliford today has been real tough to handle. He's singled, he's doubled, he's knocked in a run.
Well, Jimmy's right behind us. And Jimmy, you probably don't know this, but the top of the seventh never seems to end when the guest conductor is waiting in the wings. But you're not going to have any trouble singing it, I don't believe.
Hopefully you bring us some luck, for crying out loud. Bases are loaded. And it's already a 5-2 Philadelphia game. Relaford, 2 out of 3. Cubs need to turn 2 to get out of the jam. Shota misses. Ball 1. Phillies have walked 7 times today.
If the Cubs are going to turn 2, it's most likely going to be home to first, because Relaford has real good speed. And unless he just hits a bullet, you want to come home, because if you don't turn 2, it costs you a run that the Cubs cannot afford to give up at this point.
The 1-0. Too short. They are coming home. There's the out. Smart play at short by Manny. I don't think they would have turned 2 going 6-4-3.
No, you have to come home with it, and Alexander did just that. So they cut down the lead man, and Relaford fails to drive home the run. Good play by Alexander. And Kevin Jordan coming on to pinch hit, and he is one of their toughest pinch hitters. So Jordan comes in 8-for-27 with a homer and 5 driven in. He started the first game of this series. He'll be used as a designated hitter when the Phillies travel to play the Red Sox in Boston. And he gets an opportunity pinch hitting for Tyler Green, who did a whale of a job in his 6 innings.
And there's Jimmy Buffett getting ready just behind us. Boy, the excitement and the nerves, Steve. I can see he's very nervous about this performance coming up. Jordan swings, and he misses for strike 1.
He knows all about anguish. He's owned a lot of minor league clubs, so he knows what you go through in situations like this.
In the words of my good buddy Dave Niehaus, you've got to want to hurt. No balls and a strike. Bases are again loaded for the Phillies. They've had 2 runners thrown out at the plate in the inning. Sandy can't find it. It's right in front of the plate, though.
Well, there's a huge break, because that one bounded away from Martinez. And fortunately for the Cubs, it popped straight up in the air. Now, Mark Peixota was able to locate it. This is a good stop, because that could have easily gotten by. Peixota coming on, and so they freeze the base runners right where they stand.
And they stand at third with Lewis, at second with Parent, at first with Relaford. The Phillies have added 1 run. It's 5-2. Looking ahead to the bottom of the 7th inning, the lower third of the Cubs order is due. That's right through there. 1-2. Okay, Mark, 1 more of those and we're out of the soup here. I think Yorkis Perez is going to be the man that comes in to pitch for the Phillies. 1-2. Here it is. Hit to the right side. Grace can't make the play. It squibs past him into right field. 2 runs are going to score. How about that?
Well, you don't see Mark Grace do this often. That'll be the 4th error of the year, and it cost a couple of very big runs. Jordan hits it off the end of the bat. It takes a hop right between the legs of Grace out into right field. And Lewis scores. And Parent comes lumbering around.
And that makes it a 7-2 Philadelphia game. And back to the top of the order in Doug Glanville. So the error on Grace. And 2 more runs have scored. Glanville 0-for-4 today. Rifles it to second in time, and the side is retired, but 2 make it 3 runs score in the inning. And it's time for the 7th inning stretch with Jimmy Buffett here at Wrigley Field.
Ball game led by international recording star straight from Margaritaville, Jimmy Buffett.
Glasses, Harry. Buy me some peanuts.
sunshiny day on our first day of summer at nice family here at the ballpark, including a very young youngster. And hopefully a Cub fan for life. Hopefully that sign will come into play here in the ninth inning. The Cubs would have to put together a big-time rally as Hernandez, Alexander, and a service are due up here in the ninth inning.
Well, if Sammy does make an appearance here in the ninth, the Cubs will have something going indeed, because he's a long way back in the pecking order here in the ninth.
Don't forget, the Indians are in town tomorrow. A night game tomorrow night, a two-game series against the Tribe. Both of those games are virtually complete sellouts. There are some obstructed view seats, I guess, available, and maybe some standing room, but not much. Pickings are slim for both of those ball games. And then we're off to Detroit and Kansas City before heading back home for our final homestand before the All-Star game. Jose takes strike one.
Gomes has a very good fastball and a most unusual motion.
Really looks like he short arms the ball and falls toward the first base side of the rubber.
Well, he short arms it and he throws it over the top, which is very rare. Usually you see short armers throwing it three quarters.
One ball, one strike. It's fouled back. Cincinnati's batting in the top of the ninth inning, trailing Houston 3-1. Barry Larkin's facing Mike Magnante right now with runners at first and second and one out. The Rockies scored five in the second, six in the sixth against the Dodgers. And Colorado leads that game 11-4. Toward third. Oh, what a play by Rowland. Short hop, long throw, got it.
What a pickup by Scott Rowland. And that could have easily skipped by him, but did not. So Rowland, who does have eight errors, makes an outstanding play, and then you're not going to outrun that arm.
So the leadoff man down here in the ninth. And Manny Alexander, the hitter. He's 0 for 3 today. And he fouls it back. Barry Larkin grounds out in Houston. Cincinnati has runners now second and third with two outs. Finals in the National League. Montreal beat Atlanta 4-1. Mets beat Florida 3-2. Pittsburgh beat Milwaukee 8-7. The Brewers scored six runs in their last three at-bats to make that thing interesting. Cardinals came back to beat Arizona 5-4. So all those finals one-run thrillers. Here it's 7-2 in favor of the Phillies. And the other game in progress, San Diego over San Francisco, 4-0 in the bottom of the fifth. In the city by the bay. Two balls, two strikes. Got him swinging. So it's all up to Scott Service if the Cubs are to keep this game alive. Scott came on as a pinch hitter in the seventh, popped out to first. And a strike to Scott on the outside edge. Dante Bichette, by the way, in that game in Colorado, has driven in five runs for the Rockies. You don't want to speculate, but if you believe everything you read in the papers, Bill Russell might have a lot of job jeopardy with the outcome of that game in Colorado. No balls, two strikes. Phillies leading 7-2. The pitch just missed. It's 1-2. We'll look forward to seeing the Phillies in 1999 after today's game. They've taken 6 of 9 from the Cubs here in 98. And Service with a hard foul ball out of play. Cincinnati has fallen 3-1. So the Cubs could fall four games off the lead if they drop this one. And it's now 2-2. Cardinals 8.5 games back. Milwaukee will be 9 games back. The Cubs will be 4 games back, as all of a sudden Houston playing at home has built that lead back up. The 2-2. Over second in the right for a hit. So service keeps the Cubs' hopes alive with a soft single into right field. And Pedro Valdez will bat. He is lined out and struck out. Pedro could pick up 333 points on his batting average if he could rip a base hit here. One ball, no strikes. It's 2-0. Valdez, an original 12th round pick back in 1990 by the Cubs. The pitch is over. 2-1. This young man's hit everywhere he's played. Last year at Iowa, hit 284 in 125 games with 14 homers and 60 batted in. A minor league hitter at 288 on average. In 1996, came up with the Cubs late, got in 9 games, 8 at bats, had an RBI double to highlight the year. And he'll be 25 years old June 29th.
And this year having his best year ever.
Strike 3 called on the outside corner. And the Phillies have beaten the Cubs by a final score of 7-2. They've taken 6 of 9 from the Cubs here in 1998. And they do so very impressively today. Back with the final word and your final line score and highlights right after this timeout.
Phillies lead 3-1 as we move to the second. Alex Arias will lead it off.